Secretary, much too young, Patrick Murphy, and Army Chief of Staff General Mark Milley. I thank you both for your years of distinguished service and your continued leadership of our Army. 15 years of war have tested our Army, but time and time again our soldiers have met that test and proved their commitment, courage, and determination. It's the duty of this committee and this Congress to do our utmost to provide them the support they need and deserve. That starts by recognizing that our Army is still at war. At this moment, 186,000 soldiers are deployed in 140 locations around the globe. They're fighting terrorists and training our partners in Afghanistan and supporting the fight against ISIL, all the while defending South Korea and reassuring our allies in Eastern Europe. And the demands on our soldiers only continues to increase as the threats to our nation grow more diverse, more complex, and more severe. But despite the stark and urgent realities of the threats to our nations and the risks they pose to our soldiers, the President continues to ask the Army to do more with less. And he's done so once again with his defense budget request. The President should have requested a defense budget that reflects the scale and scope of the national security threats we face and the growing demands they impose on our soldiers. Instead, he chose to request the lowest level of defense spending authorized by last year's budget agreement and submit a defense budget that is actually less in real dollars than last year, a budget that will force our Army to confront growing threats and increasing operational demands with shrinking and less ready forces and aging equipment. By the end of the next fiscal year, the Army will be cut down to 450,000 active duty soldiers, down from a wartime peak of 570,000. These budget-driven, I repeat, budget-driven force reductions were decided before the rise of ISIL or the Russia's invasions of Ukraine. Ignoring these strategic facts on the ground, the budget request continues down the path to an army of 450,000 soldiers, an army that General H.R. McMaster, an individual known to all of us as one of the wisest soldiers, is testified earlier this week, quote, "The risk of being too small, risk being too small to secure the nation." We should be very clear that when we minimize our Army, we maximize the risk to our soldiers, the risk that in a crisis they will be forced to enter a fight too few in number and without the training and equipment they need to win. That risk will only grow worse if mindless sequestration cuts are allowed to return and the Army shrinks further to 420,000 soldiers. As our Army shrinks, readiness suffers. Just over one-third of the Army's brigade combat teams are ready for deployment and decisive operations. Indeed, just two of the Army's 60 brigade combat teams are at full combat readiness. And the Army has no plan to return to full spectrum readiness until 2021 at the very earliest. As the National Commission on the Future of the United States Army made clear in its recently published report, both the mission and the force are at risk. Meanwhile, the Army is woefully behind on modernization, and as a result, America's capability advantage in ground and airborne combat weapons systems is not nearly as great as it once was. Decades of underinvestment and acquisition malpractice have left us with an Army that is not in balance, an Army that lacks both the adequate capacity and the key capabilities to win decisively. As Vice Chief of Staff of the Army General Daniel Allen recently testified, the Army can no longer afford the most modern equipment and we risk falling behind near peers in critical capabilities. Indeed, the Army currently has no major ground combat vehicle development program underway and will continue to rely on the increasingly obsolete Bradley fighting vehicle and Abrams tanks for most of the rest of this century. As General McMaster phrased it earlier this week, the Army is, quote, outranged and outgunned by many potential adversaries. Confronted with the most diverse and complex national array of national security threats since the end of World War II, the Army urgently needs to restore readiness, halt misguided in-strength reductions, and invest in modernization. Instead, this budget request is another empty promise to buy readiness today by reducing in-strength and modernization for tomorrow. Mortgaging the future of our Army places an unnecessary and dangerous burden on our soldiers, and I believe it is the urgent task of this committee to do all we can to chart a better course. I look forward to the testimony of our witnesses today and their recommendations as to how we build the Army the nation needs and provide our soldiers with the support they deserve. I would like to now call on a former Army person for his remarks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for calling this important hearing. Let me welcome Secretary Murphy and General Milley. Thank you for your distinguished service to the nation. And as the Chairman indicated, we are reviewing the Army's proposals for the FY17 budget requests, and they're absolutely critical. And we are facing extraordinary challenges. The Chairman has outlined them very eloquently and very precisely. We have to rebuild readiness. We have to modernize the force. And it also, in this light, I think, can another message of, with no, all respect to Secretary Murphy, of getting at not an acting secretary, but a permanent secretary. And I hope we could move Mr. Fanning's nomination as quickly as possible. The President's FY2017 budget submission for the Department of the Army includes $148.1 billion in total funding, of which $125.1 billion is the base budget and $23 billion for overseas operations in the OCO account. While the budget request complies with the funding levels included in the Bipartisan Budget Act of 2015, the Army's top line is essentially flat as compared to the FY16 enacted levels. As the committee considers the Army's funding request, we must always be mindful of the risks facing our country and our national security challenges. In fact, it is highly unlikely that the demand for Army forces will diminish anytime in the near future. Currently, as the Chairman indicated, 190,000 soldiers across the active